Okay. All right. So we are now recording. So I would like to confirm the school committee members are here. So Mr. Broskall. Oh, sorry. Let me unmute you. Mr. Broskall.
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Morrison.
Yes.
Ms. Scoville.
Yes.
Okay. And Ms. Guay.
Yes.
Okay, and we are all participating remotely. The first item of order is public comment. Do we have somebody who would like to comment? Okay, Mr. Doherty, let me unmute you. Good evening. Mr. Doherty, you're muted. Okay, you're unmuted now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Joanne. This is a question, Joanne. Will the people who are attending this public meeting have an opportunity for discussion and comment during the agenda on the budget part of the meeting, or should that be done now?
That should be done now. This is the only time that there's an opportunity for public comment.
Okay, well, that I'll be very quickly. My concern is the warrant that we received in March for a town meeting, if we had ever been able to have the town meeting, had almost a $43 million budget for the school committee out of a almost $100 million budget. I thought, you know, that's all we really had. We didn't, as far as I know, get any of the breakout detail from the superintendent that was sent in the mail like we usually do. If we did, I didn't get it. So my concern is, relative to that $43 million, I know we're going to have to adjust it somewhat. How will the adjustments impact the curriculum that we have, particularly those items in the curriculum that have to do with staff? Of course, we've heard some buzz around the community that there will be some people that will need to be let go. I don't know if that's true or not. At the high school, perhaps at the middle school, I'm not sure where it's going to be. But my concern is, if it's a $2 million reduction we're looking for out of 99 million. I don't know if that's true or not, but let's say it is. And the school needs to carry half of that, $1 million. I think the school committee ought to push back pretty hard on that. The school committee should not have to bear 50% of the budget reduction if it's going to be 2 million. Does anybody know what it is? That's one of the questions. And if it's going to be programs like language and arts, I have heard that there will be no Spanish and French at the third grade level. There is going to be a position eliminated there. There may be a position in languages eliminated in high school. And if our mission is to have languages as part of what we do in the curriculum, and we're cutting out at the lowest level, then no, our job is to take care of our old people, our sick people, and our young people as a community. And if we look at the budget and start hacking away at the school budget, the first thing we do, that is a concern to me. And if we get an opportunity at town meeting to express this viewpoint, I certainly will express my viewpoint. We shouldn't have to, in the school budget, carry the full burden of a $99 million budget in terms of reduction. That's all I'd like to say at this point. I wish I had an opportunity to engage in the discussion later, but I understand why we don't. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Doherty, before you leave, could you just, for the record, state your name and address?
Yes, my name is Rich Doherty. I'm at 49 Elm Street in Bedford, Massachusetts. Birth date, 5/16/1941. Much more than you asked for, right?
Okay. All right. I thank you very much for sharing with us, Mr. Doherty. Is there anybody else who'd like to make a public comment? Let me unmute everybody. I'm just taking a look to see if anybody has raised their hand. And I don't see that, so we will move on to the next item, which is the personnel report from Mr. Sills.
Thank you. We have three resignations. One, Peter Ferguson, who is a fourth grade elementary teacher at the Lane School. Ms. Ho, who is a library education assistant at Lane. And Kyla Lyons, who is an administrative assistant at Davis. We are transferring Allison Pike Wardwell from Lane School to Davis School as a special education teacher. We are appointing Hermance September as a 1.0 guidance counselor, school counselor at the high school. Hermance graduated with a Bachelor of Science from the University of Massachusetts in Boston in biology, and then received her master's in counseling from Lesley University. And she has taught in public schools for 1 year. We are appointing Aiden Tartar, the 0.6 ELA teacher at John Glenn Middle School. She graduated from Quinnipiac University with a Bachelor of Arts in English, and then received her major, her master's in educational studies also from Quinnipiac. And she has taught for 5 years as an ELA teacher at Warren Valley Middle School. We are appointing Hannah Turner as a 1.0 literacy specialist at Bedford High School. Hannah graduated with a Bachelor of Science in Psychology from Haverford College and received her master's in speech language pathology and literacy from MGH Institute of Health Professionals. And she has worked for 4 years at Dearborn Academy. And we are very happy to have all of those new folks.
All right, I'm muting myself and I'll stop talking just to myself. Thank you very much, Mr. Sills. The next item on the agenda is a discussion about budget reduction.
We do have a job description for a school counselor at the high school.
Okay, yes. I'm sorry
also that we have to bring this before you again. I'm sure we brought this before you, but we have no record of it in our minutes. And so I'd like to just submit it again. We changed the title of guidance counselor to school counselor and made a few other minor adjustments before we brought it to you the first time. This is the same job description. We should record this as the first reading and see if there are any questions. And then we'll bring it back next week for a second reading.
Okay, thank you. Any comments from the school committee, Mr. Broskall?
My question is Ms. September not the position, not filling this position? There were two open counselors at DHS.
Could you repeat that, Dan, please? I'm sorry.
So we just hired, you're appointing Ms. September to Bedford High School as a counselor. Would this be another new counselor we're looking for, or this is her position?
This is a new position. This was a position that was originally put in the FY21 budget.
Thank you.
And when I get to the budget, I'll be glad to speak to that.
So that means there'll be two new counselors at the high school next year?
No, just one new counselor. Who else are you identifying, Dan?
No, so and you just said that we appointed Hermance September as a school counselor at Bedford High School, and this is a posting for a school counselor at Bedford High School. So is that a different position for another new counselor?
There's only one new position that was open for Bedford High School.
Am I asking the question wrong? I'm sorry, maybe I am. So we're posting a position to hire a new counselor, but we just appointed a new counselor. So will there be Hermance plus another new counselor at Bedford High School is the question.
No, there was only should only have been one posting. Maybe it hasn't been taken down, but Hermance filled that posting.
Okay.
Okay, Mr. Morrison, do you have any questions? Sorry, you're muted.
I just unmuted and you muted me back.
Sorry.
It's all right. I think I have the same question that Mr. Brosco is trying to ask.
Yeah,
so
I understand.
What we're doing now is just approving the job description for a posting that has already essentially been filled. Is that right?
The job description is simply a change in title and language.
Okay.
It has nothing to do with postings. It's just clarifying. This actually came before you about 6 weeks ago.
Yep.
I apologize. We did go through it.
Yep.
But somehow it didn't get registered as having
got it
on. And so we just want to make sure we're covered that way.
Okay. I think you cleared that up for both me and Dan now. Thank you.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Guay, questions?
No questions.
Okay. Ms. Scoville, do you have questions?
No questions. Thank you.
Okay. I do not have any questions either. I had the same question. It's already been answered. Okay. So now we're ready to move on to the budget discussion, John.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to share my screen.
Can I make a brief preface to this? So Bedford, like nearly all other communities, is expecting some financial challenges in the coming fiscal year as a result of the pandemic and the economic fallout that's related to that. Our town leadership is being really prudent and proactive and planning for these challenges. I'd like to emphasize that, as far as I understand this, it's a reduction to a previously developed budget increase for the next fiscal year, but it's not an actual decrease to the budget that we have had this year. I would further just like to thank John, Julie Corain, the Director of Finance, and members of the district leadership team who have put a lot of work into developing this revision.
Okay, just give me a moment to bring up the my computer turned off, and I'm just, give me a second, please. Okay, before I share the screen, let me just say, add to Joanne's introduction by saying that the school's share of the, so what the town has been confronted with and the schools as part of the town is a projected loss in state revenues of about 15% of the municipal aid and a similar projection of lost revenue in Chapter 70, which is school funding. In addition to that, there's been a significant loss of funding in local receipts, and the school's share of that of responding to that expected revenue shortfall is actually 60% of the total shortfall, and the total figure for the schools that we were asked to address was $1,278,000. About half of which is due to lack of state revenues, and about half of which is due to loss of local receipts. And so the schools set out to find ways to reduce its budget in ways that would have the least impact on students, on teaching and learning, on class size, on programs, and therefore on staff positions, which are the lion's share of our budget. And of course, we care as well about our staff and our faculty and staff as well. So I'm going to share what those budget reductions are. They are not an absolute reduction from the FY20 budget, but they are a reduction from what we proposed in March. And my response to Mr. Daugherty with regard to that is, because we canceled town meeting, we did not send out the budget newsletter at that time, but we will be doing that prior to this town meeting so that everybody will have the detail that they need. What this, the net result of this is that we had agreed with Finance Committee on a 3.5% increase for FY21, plus a $450,000 reserve for extraordinary out-of-district special ed costs. The result of these reductions will bring us to about a 0.4% increase over FY21 instead of a 3.5% increase. And rather than simply eliminate all of the requests in the FY21 budget request, We went back and looked at the whole budget because some of the things we had sought to add in the FY21 budget in the 1% expansion were things that we don't think we can do without, and therefore we are reducing some other positions and some other expenses. Those include a number of special ed positions for our SALE program, both at Davis for SALE inclusion and at JGMS, where our numbers autism program are increasing significantly, and we need that special education staff. In addition, we have moved to include the counseling position at the high school that we had sought to include in the 1.0 expansion. We're maintaining that because we expect that one of the purposes of that expansion, or that addition, I should say, was to enable our present counselor who is in charge of our Lighthouse program that takes care of students returning from hospitalizations and helps to integrate them back into the full program. We expect that with the COVID-19, we are going to have increased number of students who are out for extended periods of time. And we need to be able to accommodate them when they come back. And we also think that the social emotional needs of our students, which have been tested sorely during this period, they will continue to be tested, and we need that support staff. So with that said, let me share the screen and take you through the proposed changes. Joanne, I think you've disabled screen sharing. If you could check that. If you go to...
So I went to share screen and said multiple participants can share simultaneously.
Let me try it again. Oh, here we go. Okay, we're good. See if I can. Okay, can people see that screen? Can you make up the text big enough? All right, so, oops. Hold on a second, please. Still big enough? Okay. So,
John, we're still seeing your email.
You are. That's not good. Hold on. I'm sorry. Just give me a moment, please.
Sure.
Can you see it now?
Yes.
Just expand it. Okay. So coming out of FY20, we recognized, based on the experience of FY20, that we will need to expand our substitute budget for FY21, particularly with the past year or two's worth of experience with long-term subs, to the tune of about $200,000. And we derived, after attending to other needs like circuit breaker and special education, $200,000 in savings from FY20, which we're applying going forward to FY21 to take care of that need. So that's not directly COVID-19 related. So we start at zero. The first place we looked, of course, was in professional development supplies and materials. We are going to retain our iPads for a fourth year, which will save us $65,641. We are making a 10% reduction in supplies and materials across the board for $109,350. I should say that we have not really increased our supply line for the last 10 years. So we don't do this lightly, partly because we think we may be out of school for some time, we think that we can survive with a 10% reduction. 20% reduction in text replacement for $19,399. We're eliminating expected expansion in IT contracted services for $10,800. We're eliminating expansion in facilities contracted service for $20,000, and we'll just have to make up the difference in-house one way or another. We had planned to add a JV hockey program, and that has costs both in terms of personnel and in terms of uniforms and buses and referees, et cetera. So we're eliminating the JV hockey expansion at $13,372. We're reducing district-wide professional development by $35,000. Uniform replacement for our athletics department, $8,000. Athletic equipment replacement, $1,700. And our youth risk survey, biannual, $13,404. For a total of $269,858. We next looked at non-salary FTE. We had put in our original budget for some additional summer days for our Davis and Lane system principals who have to work more days than they get paid. This was going to be an incremental change eventually to grow to a significant increase in summer days, but we're going to eliminate that going forward. We're proposing to eliminate that going forward. The stipend for coach for JV hockey expansion, $4,657. Summer interns custodial and IT, $11,700. Mentor new teacher stipends. We're moving to fund grant funding for that, so we save $16,000 that way. We're reducing extracurricular activities to a partial year, and we're suspending some entirely. So for the majority of extracurricular activities, we won't start them until November. So we'll save a percentage of the cost of all of those stipends. And there are a few Davis activities that we will eliminate altogether. And we will suspend curriculum stipends at JGMS, Davis, and Lane. Presently, as you know, our program administrators are 6 through 12, and our program directors are K through 12, and they are assisted at the middle school with a curriculum coordinator for each department, social studies, science, math, et cetera, and at the elementary schools, social studies and science, both at Lane and Davis. So we will be proposing to eliminate those stipends. Professional teacher reductions. We're looking to reduce a 0.2 English teacher at the high school. That will not be the loss of a person, it's a loss of a position. Reduce world language in grade three, which is 0.4 for Spanish and French, for $51,275. Let me just say about this decision, this was not an easy decision, but budget is not the only impetus for making this decision. We've been looking at this for some years, particularly because of the need to put more time into literacy and reading for so many of our third grade students. With the loss of learning time that COVID-19 has created in these last 3 months, we are desperately in need of finding time at the third grade level to recover that reading instruction, phonics instruction, literacy overall. And the place that we think we can find that is by eliminating world language at grade three, which is three 20-minute periods per week. And so that is the, that, and then again, the fiscal imperative as well. We're reducing, proposing to reduce the gifted and talented teacher at Lane 0.2 for $14,708. And we are looking to reduce one instructional coach position at the high school for $82,951. And in that case, we do not expect that person will, the person who holds that position will move into another position at the high school. So it's not backfilling with the reduction of the instructional coach. Paraprofessional salary, we are reducing all the library EA positions. Right now we have a 1.0 at all three elementary and middle school, and a 0.6 at the high school. So eliminating 3.6 FTE for $89,408. We're proposing to eliminate the academic achievement one academic achievement center teaching assistant at the high school. There are two or three that will still be, those positions will still be maintained. We're reducing a 5-day sub at each of the four schools. We don't expect there to be a direct savings there, but we think that that will help us control those costs. We're reducing two teaching assistant behavioral tech positions at Davis School for $57,373. And we're proposing to reduce the teaching assistant that we were going to add to help offset class size at third grade, since in the original budget, we did not propose a 10th third grade teacher. Salary administration, we are eliminating expansion of the preschool administrative assistant. We were going to add a 0.3 administrative assistant at Davis School. We are, as you'll see further down, we're looking for 0% COLA for virtually all of our faculty and staff. This is where we show that all non-contracted personnel, which is our principals, our central administrators, our computer technicians, our business office, et cetera, will get a 0% increase. And we're looking to reduce the computer lab position at JGMS for $32,834. Facilities, we had sought to increase our facilities, our custodial support by 0.5 at across the district, $24,527. We're proposing not to increase that, not to implement that. We have an additional cost that we're expecting. Well, actually, it's not an additional cost. It's an additional loss of revenue that we're expecting. We built $144,079 into the FY20 budget originally because we expected to receive that amount as part of the Student Opportunity Act, new commitment to offset special ed transportation. Certainly a 95 to 99% chance that that will not be available at the same time that other funds will not be available. We thought it was fiscally responsible to reduce in ways that would help to offset that cost as well, so we weren't moving into next year with a deficit, an expected deficit. We also expect to lose about $67,000 in building rental in the fall, which had also been built into the FY21 budget. And we're expecting at minimum a $10,000 increase in our legal services, particularly in terms of possible special ed cases. So our net after taking care of those increased expenses is $707,653 reduction, or 15.4 FTE. And then we are budgeting for 0% for all other employees whose contracts are up at this time, which would be another $570,347 for COLA, 0% for COLA, for a total of
$1,278,000. Do you want to take questions now, John?
Yes, I think that'd be great.
Okay. So we'll start with Mr. Broskall. Sorry, Dan, you're muted and I can't unmute you.
How's that? Is that better?
Yes, I can hear you now, Dan.
Joanne, you got me?
Yes, I do. Let me just say one last thing.
Wait, sure.
Because we have been meeting the chair of the finance committee, chair of the selectmen, chair of the school committee, our finance director, Julie, and Victor Garofalo, and I meeting to look at this as a townwide issue. And I think that it's important to put these very challenging changes in the context of what we're concerned will be a 2 or 3 year problem. And I just think that that's important by way of context.
Great. Joanne, do you want me to go now?
Please.
All right. Yeah, so I have thoughts. I have a small soapbox. It sucks going first here because I'm sure that as other people ask questions, I'll have more to say, but let me get this off my chest and then we'll see if I have stuff at the end. So, I mean, first of all, John, you're absolutely right. And Rich, you're absolutely right. You know, we are sitting here on the precipice of a deep recession, which everybody appreciates, that we're going to suffer through together with the town. And, you know, we do have a choice, right? We could say we're not going to do it and then say we're just going to jack everybody's taxes up or take it away from other departments, which I'm absolutely not willing to do. So I think what we need to say is, look at this. What can we live with? What can't we live with? How good can we do? There's no law on the books that says we have to cut X, but we will do, you know, whatever we think we can to help out everybody. And that's my attitude. Philosophically, I approach this with a couple of axioms. Number one is, teachers are pretty sacred, you know, in this town and to me and to this budget. And I'll leave that at the top. And then everything else is not. And in that, what is not is some program stuff, certainly materials. And I'm sorry, like professional development for me, like can come off for the sake of teachers more or less anytime we're comfortable with it. So I am not going to sort of litigate items here. That's conceptually where I'm coming from. And my last sort of non-specific ramble is, you know, this is certainly, John and Julie, you know, your attempt to give us some options. And I respect both of your opinions more than anybody else in the room. There could be a broader conversation where you take our input. I don't want to get there. I trust you to lead us along the way. And I like where we come. And I can live with most of it, but I can't live with some of it. So just a couple of questions about subs. because for years we fine-tuned that number in the budget. It used to be $75,000 per building per year. Then we increased it to 85. Then we hired full-time building subs in each building. So what does this number really say we're going back to compared to where we were before? Are we still going to struggle with fill rate? Are we not? Are we going to save what we were spending on this year? What does that number really look like right now compared to where it's been?
So let me just clarify one thing and then see if Julie wants to respond. So I don't believe it was 75,000 per building. I think what it was is the daily sub rate was $75 a day, and we increased that to 85 because we were having a hard time attracting subs. And we have some communities, quite frankly, are 95 and 105. We're diving into our sub costs virtually doubled in the last 3 years. A lot of that had to do with just the way the dice rolled around long-term leaves of absence. We just had a lot of long-term leaves, pregnancy leaves, et cetera. And as you know, when that happens, you know, for a good part of that time, you're actually paying two salaries. We think we may help to control the cost some by having one building sub. That was a new initiative this year to go to two. Yep. So we'll try going back to one and see if that can control some costs a little better. We do think that we will have, because of high unemployment, we do think that there's going to be plenty of people looking to sub. But in terms of the fiscal picture, I don't know, Julie, if you have anything else you want to say about that.
So one thing, just with a careful review of the spending on substitutes, John is correct. We are absolutely spending the vast majority, or I would say actually 100% of the sub budget is being used for long-term subs who are covering teachers. So, so our sub costs have sort of galloped away. We're going to need to focus attention on that to both track and control costs going forward. It is also not uncommon for subs. Subs is unpredictable. You have a lot of babies born 1 year. It's very, very difficult to plan or control. But we have, we are on it. We're going to track it better, and we have caught the issue.
Yeah, I mean, not to dive into this year's budget, I assume you saved some amount of money with not paying subs for a couple of months for day-to-day substitutes. Is that correct, or is that not correct?
Well, it's complicated, actually. Yes, we did. It's complicated. But yes, we did have the occasional subs. But again, this year, my analysis showed that the at least $300,000 of the costs were to do with long-term subs.
Okay. Thank you. I think we understand complications over here. I'm just wondering if the high school and the middle school do not resume a regular schedule in the fall, will you continue to see savings by not having to have people in classrooms for a couple of months? So I think I'm excited about savings, of course. And obviously we cannot predict when people are going to be going out, but there is some volatility. This could trend in our direction favorably, I'm guessing, is my comment on that.
Yes, absolutely, okay. Dan.
Great. Mm-hmm. As a third grade parent for next year, and third grade will be the biggest grade in the system, I do recall very clear the conversation we had about that TA as opposed to a teacher. I casually support taking away because I know what that means. I have a gigantic problem taking out world language. I'm sorry, and I would not support that, and I won't support it. That's just my own personal opinion moving forward with this. I think it's critical to these kids. It's special about Bedford. It's special for our kids. And it works out well, and we built space at Lane for it. So I think we should use it. That's my own personal opinion on a soapbox. I do understand the JV hockey cut in the scheme of $1.2 million. It isn't a lot. I don't like it. I'm not sure if I want to die on that hill. But John, can you explain for a second, when you're saying extracurricular, does that include athletics, or is that all extracurriculars or some that won't start until November?
That's activities.
Okay.
We look closely at athletics. We have very robust conversations about that. We, you know, our kids lost the whole season. And we decided that athletics are really critical to the emotional health of so many of our kids and their level of engagement in school. Now, there may be savings that we have no control over because we may not be allowed to do contact sports. If that happens, we're going to be able to come back to these items and take another look at them, because we'll find savings in the athletic budget that way. But we did not, we can't count on that. And if we are able to go forward, we decided not to cut athletic programming.
Right. And that's a challenge right now. Like, we could be sitting here in September having staggered hours and no sports, saying, actually, we're sitting on, you know, another $250,000 in savings that we're not going to spend. What do we do with the cuts? What can we reinstitute now? It would be too late, for example, for a foreign language teacher. It would not be too late to put JV hockey back in. And I think that's my kind of statement on that. John, could you scroll down for a second? Because I didn't want to look at the TAs again.
Yes.
And I think I missed your explanation about what the TABTs were for 57,000. Those are behavior techs?
Those are behavior techs, yes.
For preschool, for Davis, for who?
For Davis, and there's one, so we have
just Davis.
Yeah, just Davis.
And just some rationale about, I mean, those jobs, as some of us know, are really intense and really immersive and very challenging, and people burn out tons. Is that not a critical position to support kids with special ed at Davis? How will it be delivered differently without them?
This was done in conjunction with Marianne. Part of what's going on here is a repurposing of some funds at Davis to enable us to hire more related service personnel. We are hiring some half-time personnel, not like a full-fledged speech and language person, but like a CODA and a language assistant. So we're going to actually have the same number of people available to be in classrooms, but we think it's a better service given what those caseloads have been. And Beth and Marianne are all part of this process and this plan, and they think this can work.
Okay. Those are my only questions at this point, offered with only the respect for how challenging this is, how much work it took. And I thank you for indulging me.
Sure.
Thank you. Mr. Morrison?
So let me first start off by echoing the thanks and the appreciation for all the hard work and the difficulty of the challenge that you're facing. I really appreciate that you've gotten us this close to where we are. And I'll also say that I sort of echoed Mr. Broskell's philosophy about this, that there are certain things that are closer to sacred and other things that are less painful to see go away. And I think that that keeping teachers is absolutely our highest priority. So I have a couple of mundane questions and then a couple of more sort of challenging ones. First, I want to start with, could you scroll back up a little, John? I see a 10% reduction in supplies. And I guess I'm a little curious about this because I'm thinking that there will be some additional costs also. For example, things like PPE and additional cleaning supplies and so on. So is this number net of what we think are going to be increases associated with sort of a reopening after the pandemic or during the next part of the pandemic? Or is there something else, somewhere else for that?
So we have backed out of the operating budget hundreds of thousands of dollars of technology, disinfectant supplies, hand sanitizer dispensers, plexiglass barriers,
uh-huh,
and PPE,
uh-huh,
and distant learning programs like Lexi, et cetera, which we are going to pay for through CARES Act 3 monies.
Okay.
The town is getting about $1.2 million. We're looking for our at least 50%, hopefully 60 or 70% of that. And then $175,000 in state technology aid.
Okay.
Gordon and the legislature helped us to get. So we're taking care of all that. This is instructional materials and those kinds of things.
Okay.
Office supplies, et cetera.
Okay, good. Thank you. That's very helpful. And then scroll down a little, please, to the, there it is. It's very silly. You don't have to scroll down. At the bottom of that group of professional development, there's a youth risk survey that reads as though it is a cost. I don't see a minus sign in front of it. And I want to understand if that's correct or if that is just a typo.
I can answer that one.
Yeah.
It is correct. It's a net okay. number and it is an increase.
Uh-huh.
That's sort of the central supply line that carries things like, we noticed earlier that the youth risk survey is biannual and does not need to be budgeted next year because it's happening this year. Actually, it was delayed, but it's not, the cost is covered this year, not next. But we did actually increase a few things, not the lion's share that John was referring to that we were not, we did not have to burden the operating budget with. Thank goodness, because of the CARES Act 3 relief funds that are coming. But there were some slight increases. So that is correct. It's a positive number. It was a little bit of an increase there.
Okay. Thanks, Julie.
Okay.
Substantively important comment is it's interesting that Mr. Brosgall sort of kind of zoomed in on this as well. I am not a parent of a third grader, but my reaction to looking at this was that third grade is bearing a heavy burden here. If we're thinking about taking away the world languages and we're also cutting that TA position, I too recall that we put that position in as a solution to the increasing class size that we were expecting in grade three. And so it feels to me like we're sort of doing a little slippery slide of a little too much burden on the third graders. Now, there may be some other things here that show that this is more equally distributed elsewhere because the grades for the other ones aren't as prominently displayed in the report here. But it feels to me like that's a little too much on third grade. So I think I'm leaning toward the soapbox that I would get on is that, you know, this is a solution. And as Dan said, the solution doesn't necessarily have to be that we have to take all of the cuts that are on this list. And I would be starting to prioritize world languages and that third grade TA as well as something that I would want to try to hold on to. And I also had the question about reducing extracurriculars, but I guess that was answered for Mr. Broskell. So I think I can stop there and pass it on to my next colleague.
Ms. Guay?
Sorry. Hi, everyone. A couple of questions and then a couple of observations. As I look through the proposed cuts, one of the ones we're looking at, mentor and new teacher stipends are grant funded. Do we have any other outstanding grant applications that you anticipate may come through that could fund other items in our budget?
We have some guidance. Guidance department is pursuing some grants. We do not have any other major grants other than the ones that we are have coming to us by law, like our SPED grant, et cetera.
Okay.
This time.
And I may have asked this question before, but I'll repeat it. Julie, are we accessing all our Mass Health dollars for our children with special needs who also are on Common Health and Mass Health?
Well, we do have a consultant who does our Medicaid claiming, and we are receiving revenues. The town receives those revenues, and they do come in, if that's what you're referring to, Anne.
And they comb through all of the app. They comb through all the students. They figure out who. Do they know everyone who qualifies for Mass Health and Common Health in the town?
I'm not going to be able to answer the detailed questions on that, but we could get back to you. That is, we work closely with the Medicaid claiming process. Our special ed department supports that, and we, you know, comply with all of the data collection efforts that they require of us to be able to make those claims.
Just because one of the changes we've seen in the last year or two is many, many children with autism who come from more middle class, more affluent families than you would typically expect to see receiving Mass Health now obtain Common Health because it pays for all their ABA stipends and or ABA co-pays. It's not terribly expensive. It was a mechanism set up by the state. And as a result, those kids' services, we could take some of those dollars back, and you might not necessarily, they're not free lunch kids, they're not kids that you're going to necessarily think would be on Mass Health. I'm just looking for extra sources of income that we may not have seen. Mm-hmm. And then John, when we had our last meeting, one of the questions I had is, would it be possible for, or to at least offer some folks the opportunity to go to 4/5? Clearly we can't ask an art teacher to work 4/5. But has there been any discussion about that, or at least putting that option out there for folks that might voluntarily opt to make a little bit less by working less days?
Yeah, we did think about that after you made the suggestion. And we're concerned about, you know, at this point we're getting down to, you know, anything we do has direct impact on teaching and learning. And so reducing TAs to 4/5.
Well, I was thinking more administrators, people, program administrators, people who are compensated in a different way who aren't necessarily in the classroom.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I misunderstood what you had suggested. No, we have not looked at that specifically.
The only reason I was asking is many, many in the private sector now are telling folks, you're working 4/5. You're at 80% now, you're getting 4 days a week. Not that we want, I'm not saying to demand that, but there may be some people interested in having a lighter load, and that would be additional savings. It may, especially everything that's going on, some folks might welcome the idea to only come in 4 days a week. Mm-hmm. I know it makes managing them a little more difficult, but there are ways to do that. And there's another example where we might be able to pull back some dollars that we wouldn't have to cut from other more important programs. So I just want to reiterate that. Like Dan and Brad, I appreciate all the effort that's gone into this. This isn't easy. This is not what any of us anticipated even 4 or 5 months ago. But so we pushed forward. I too struggle with the idea of eliminating third grade language. It's not something I want to see happen. And so I will voice my concern about it and then try to find money somewhere else as we go through this process. And the same, and maybe folks look at it differently, but I was very moved by all of the hockey parents that came to our meeting and explained, you know, we talk about how important sports are to our students. And I know hockey's an ad, it's a new one. It's not something the hockey JV team was not something we've had in the past. And this is something we added on this year. Again, as we go through this process, that's something I'd like to see. If you could just answer a couple of other questions, John, how many instructional coaches do we currently have at the high school? I know we're going to eliminate one.
We have one.
Point eight. So then we won't have any?
Point eight. Correct. What?
So what are they going to do instead if they're not going to be an instructional coach?
So what may happen, and I can't say that it has happened because, you know, we posted the position and we have to let the posting go forward. But a very positive scenario would be that the instructional coach would take on the position of academic achievement academic achievement director, which is a vacated position. the person who's in the position this past few years is transferring to a different position within the district.
So then we just simply wouldn't fill it?
That's correct.
Okay. And again, it's the summer and schools are going to open, we hope, in the fall. Have we given any thought to not posting any new positions? Just stop posting?
We've given it thought and we've rejected it because we need those positions.
Okay. And then turning to the discussion,
These are classroom positions. We looked at whether we could not post and increase class size. That didn't seem like a viable solution.
Okay. And then looking at the TAs, the behavioral techs, and I believe you said Marianne and folks have looked at this and believe that they can continue to offer the services that are required with fewer techs. I just want to remind everyone that while every student has been out of school since March, children with autism have gotten, just because of the nature of the disability, it has been next to impossible to teach them, especially the younger children. I would anticipate students are going to come back with more challenging behaviors. I don't believe we've decided what we're doing this summer. And then to pull two TAs from the room, that seems a bit difficult to picture what that would exactly look like, because the TAs do all the drills. And if we're still doing ABA classrooms, that's going to be harder. Now, I know we're saying we're going to have other folks there who we're going to bring in. Are we going to hire extra?
This is for sale inclusive, not sale intensive.
So just the inclusive. Okay.
Yes.
And, so these are the children that we push into classrooms who have autism, and they're no longer in substantially separate classrooms. They're being in with their regular, their typical peers.
And in the expansion budget, we were adding a SAIL inclusion teacher, a professional, and three TAs. What we're going to do instead is add the SAIL inclusion teacher, one TA, and a half-time CODA and a half-time speech and language person.
I'm sorry, what's a CODA? Forgive me, I don't know what that is.
A CODA is a physical therapy. It's a physical therapist assistant. So it's not a full. Fully licensed. There's a certificate license for a physical therapist assistant that districts use all the time to support the work of the physical therapist and the occupational therapist, and that's what this person is. So this is a person who will be doing direct services under the license and supervision of our PT person, and will be doing push-in into the classes, etc. So
obviously the IEPs are going to dictate what services people are entitled to. As we stepped away from pull out models and push everybody in, there's just a lot of kids with a lot of needs. Have we given consideration to just going to outside agencies and bringing these people in and then not having to, we can hire people and not have to pay them benefits and just pay them on an hourly rate? Or is that's probably harder in a push-in model? I assume they've given thought to that.
We did give thought to that. And let me just say, as you know, and you know, we are ethically obligated, ethically and legally obligated.
Legally, yeah. So,
but it's also an ethical issue for us to meet the needs of our kids and to meet the needs of the IEPs. You know, if the year proceeds and we have to add another behavior tech, we're going to be finding a way to add another behavior tech.
I guess my concern is when we did the presentation on the co-teach model, we have some room for growth there. We've put teachers in place. They believe the students benefit from it, but it's a tough model. It requires a lot of support. So if that's the way we're going, where kids aren't being pulled out anymore and they're going to push in, obviously, we'll leave that up to Marianne, but there are concerns. With respect to the legal services, is that still an issue that they're going to be doing extra stuff? I thought that was over now. Or we still need to have...
We're expecting, just as you said, that the expectations around special ed services and whether there are compensatory services or okay. however it is that, that we work things out with families through the IEP process, we expect that there may be some need okay. for legal counseling.
So that's more when students come back or ES or looking at extended school year services. Okay.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. And then assistant grants and the services and the fourth-fifths. And what are we hearing anything more on circuit breaker, or they're just not talking about it? Are we hearing anything about percentages?
There's a petition that, you know, we've been writing letters to our congressman to support circuit breaker as it's been at the level that it's been in the past number of years. So that is, there's, you know, rumblings at the State House, but Julie, you may have some more information on that.
We're still waiting for information from the state about all sorts of budget matters.
Are our lawyers hearing anything? No?
I actually reached out to the DESE finance person, Jay Sullivan, just to make sure I hadn't missed anything, combing through whatever data, and I actually felt better that he said he was also in the dark. So everyone is waiting for this information. And unlike Bedford needs to pass a budget now and is making decisions based on their best guesses, the state is still waiting to decide and putting okay. us all in a tough position, but we'll get through it.
And is it safe to assume, for purposes of budget, if our circuit breaker number comes back higher than we anticipate, we could revisit these decisions, specifically, especially language, hockey, or whatever, what this final cut list looks like?
Not only if circuit breaker comes back, but if there's also some talk of Chapter 70 not being cut to the level that we're expecting, if at all, because the gateway cities absolutely will be devastated. And so, you know, if our revenue end up being higher, then we will absolutely, you know, move to restore whatever we can restore.
And so that's why I'll continue through this process as Dan and Brad, as the others will do, sort of to highlight what their, the items they would like to not see removed in the event compensation money becomes available, that we can quickly access it, just so that you understand where we are on this. So
yes.
That's all I have at this point. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Scoville?
Hi. I'm going to start with the third grade issue. I, for full transparency, I am also a parent of a rising third grader, or soon to be rising third grader. John, you started this whole presentation by saying that we're trying not to impact class size. And before all of this, in December, I remember being introduced to this idea that the third grade was the worst off, or the biggest class of the whole school, of the whole system. So I'm more worried about this TA than I am about the world language, especially if we cut the world language and the students will be in the classrooms more and having to make up for lost time in the classrooms more, I think they definitely need more support. And I think that, again, to echo Dan and others, the world language is a huge benefit that we have, and it would be great to hold on to that too. But again, I'm really concerned about cutting a TA and having less support for those big classes. I was also in overheard a class meeting today, and the world language is, a lot of this stuff is already being talked about. The kids are getting excited about it. I think we have to figure out when to talk to families. I think it's going to be a huge pushback from the community. And of course, the JV hockey, I'm disappointed about. Like Anne was saying, I'm wondering how we put stuff on like the what if list. there are some priorities that we all have, and that if we do get some more money than we anticipate, I guess all of us just need to highlight this this document and make sure that we follow up on the stuff that we are really concerned about. So those are my big things. But again, I'm really worried about the third grade. Thank you.
Sorry. So I'm just going to round back again because he was the first person. I remember how frustrating it could be to be the first person to ask questions. Mr. Boskal, do you have any further questions? Hold on, you're muted.
Hello?
There you go.
Yeah, I have no additional questions, thank you.
Thank you. So I have a couple of questions. John, could you just explain the literacy piece of the third grade TA?
Yeah, it's not the third grade.
Well, I'm sorry, it's the world language, that piece.
So let me preface this by just saying none of this is easy. The Bedford Public Schools budget does not have fluff. And so everything we cut is going to have an impact. Mm-hmm. And our task is to minimize that impact as much as possible because we're in a national fiscal crisis that's impacting our schools. We are very concerned about the loss of learning that's gone on in the last 3 months and about the continued loss of learning that's going to happen going forward, because we are not going to be school as usual in the fall. There's just no question. And the most likely model that we will be going to, and I was going to talk about this in my superintendent's report, but I think it's relevant here. The most likely model, which will be actually prescribed by the Department of Elementary and Secondary.
Somebody's off mute.
As good as anybody's, but that doesn't always translate into getting big.
Okay. Well, thank you for the musical interlude. Mr. Sills, I apologize.
No, that's okay. So, Department of Elementary, the commissioner made it known earlier this week to the superintendents that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education will be prescribing what school will look like in the fall. Individual districts can petition for some relief from that prescription. We actually welcome the prescription so that districts are not compared to their neighbor districts in terms of whether you're open or not open, et cetera. Most likely, it is going to be a hybrid model where kids will be home. Some of the kids will be home while other kids are in school, and then some kind of alternating between home and school. We are going to lose more learning time during that time than we've lost already, because there's just no way for our younger kids that distant learning can do what face-to-face learning can do with teachers who have built real relationships and can respond to individual needs, particularly because the younger kids are not independent learners. They need their parents to help them access the technology, et cetera. Even our secondary level students will suffer, not only social emotionally with the lack of community, but again, real instruction takes place in the classroom where deeper learning. So that being said, we are very concerned about our ability of our kids to learn how to read. And we know based on our assessments and that we have many, many kids going into third grade who are not proficient and that haunts them for the years to come. Mm-hmm. We think that number, because of the lack of learning time, the loss of learning time before and going forward, is going to increase significantly. And so we are actually, as hard as it is to think about giving up world language in third grade for a year, this is a year decision. If there's any further discussion about whether that should take place for a longer time, that would have to come before the school committee because it would be a change in program. But we're actually excited about the opportunity to have more time spent on literacy for all third graders as a result of that. And that's something that our Lane School principal, our K through five literacy director, and we have the support, as tough as it has been, from Dana Curran, our world language program director. The kids pick it up in fourth grade. We are still well ahead of most districts that don't start until middle school or later. So the kids will actually, they will still get an enrichment experience in the following year. I, like Sarah, am more concerned that we actually, invited the school committee to vote on the FY21 budget not to include a 10th third grade teacher because we proposed this teaching assistant. And I'm happy to go back and look at our reserves to see whether there's any chance of restoring that. But so it's not just a fiscal issue, but it's I don't know whether we would have proposed it if we also didn't have the fiscal impetus, but it certainly was something that we were looking at closely even before we knew we had to cut.
Okay, thank you for that. That was very helpful, and I agree that that third grade TA should be the first, at the very top of the, if we can find more money, list. Let's see, so my next question is, when you had talked about the 0.8 instructional coach, could you repeat what you said about that that position?
Sure. So the present instructional coach, who's phenomenal, is 0.8 instructional coach and 0.2 English teacher. And so we're looking to pick up the 0.2 either through changes in scheduling or somebody else picking up that 0.2 teaching. There's a recommendation that the present person who's the instructional coach would move into the director of student achievement position. If you remember, we changed Audrey's position midway through this year. Audrey, who is our elementary director of student achievement, in part because we felt that we didn't have the luxury of instructional coaching only happening when teachers voluntarily ask for that support. Many teachers have asked for it, but often the teachers who ask for it are teachers trying to grow in particular ways and looking for that support. And what we determined at the elementary level is that coaching really needs to be more directed towards helping teachers who need to implement tiered intervention within their classes learn how to do that more effectively. And so as Audrey's actually presenting next week, this whole approach to tiered intervention and more targeted coaching. And we're looking to move to that model at the secondary level as well. So if the instructional coach who's presently in the instructional coach position does move into that position, if other people don't, if she's interested in the position and other people don't contend for it and she is chosen, she will still be doing instructional coaching, but it'll just be more targeted instructional coaching.
Okay. So this is a, okay. All right. Thank you. Go ahead.
I just want to be clear that, you know, when we do come to a vote, I'm only going to be asking you to vote the number.
Mm-hmm.
That you're not actually approving each one of these individual changes, that mm-hmm. really, up to the administration to figure mm-hmm. out. This is our draft of what it would look like to get. Mm-hmm. We want you to know when, if you decide to vote for the number or not, that this would be the cost of doing that business. But there's still the potential for wiggle room within this.
Sure, sure. And then I just was curious about what makes up the text reduction and text replacement. Is that library books? Is that textbooks?
Julie, I'm going to ask you to respond to that.
Sure.
Largely library. Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a combination, Joanne. There are some trimming of library book replacements, some trimming of damaged book replacements. It's not none of the lines that were for wholesale needed mm-hmm. texts or workbooks in schools were reduced. It was very targeted towards sort of the replacement of the worn.
Okay.
That we felt we could delay a year on.
Okay. That's great. Thank you very much. I don't have any further questions. Do you have more to share in this?
Sorry, could I ask one more question, Joanne?
Yeah.
Sure.
John, was any thought given at all to changing the co-teach models at JGMS or Davis or Lane to add some savings?
So I think there's a misconception about the cost of co-teaching in Bedford. We've literally added one teacher to transition to co-teaching in Bedford. We've repurposed our teachers so that they are spending more of their time in classes rather than pulling kids out. But we've actually, it has not been particularly costly for Bedford to do that.
So we've only hired one new teacher.
In order to make that transition, yes.
So we just pushed in all of the special ed and made them co-teachers?
That's correct.
Okay.
And we've hired additional special ed staff for our special programs. You know, I mean, our special ed staffing doubled over 10 years. But that had to do with creating new programs, which some of which are sub-separate, whether it's the STEP program or et cetera. But for our moderate need students and now our second one will be this SAIL inclusion. So we've added new staff for our special programs, all right, whether it's SAIL sub-separate, SAIL inclusion, or STEP program. But in terms of our moderate need students who are typically mainstream, but we're largely being pulled out predominantly into learning centers, there's been a shift in the model, but not an increase in staffing.
So are we saving any money, as you just raised the point, of not doing pullouts as much anymore? So now we push in speech, we push in OT, we're pushing everybody in. Is there savings there? Because they're not getting the hours of services that they once got.
Well, they're getting the services that are in their IEPs. And there's still, most of our practitioners are doing some combination of push-in and pull-out. So we still have learning centers. But our kids, some kids are not spending time in learning centers. Some are getting two times per week in a learning center, but the rest of the time is pushed in. It's all based on the individual needs of kids and how they're placed and how they're supported. Be glad to do a presentation around that.
No. I'm just looking for additional savings. I'm trying to figure out, is there some, I know you've combed through this, and I'm just trying to bring an extra set of eyes and see if there might be other methods, other line items that we could look at to protect some of the other cuts that we're proposing. So, when you say, and this is how it always works with the budget, basically we agree on a number you listen to what we say, but ultimately administration will decide where the cuts are. It's not up to school committee.
Correct.
Okay. Ian, is that all?
For now, yeah, thanks.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Broskall has his hand up.
Yep.
There you go.
A question, I mean, given what we're hearing about staggering grades, how is that going to impact busing and transportation costs?
We don't know, Dan, and that's why we could be in a completely different situation come September.
Right.
And need an emergency special town meeting to draw on town reserves for $500,000 to $1 million to make teaching and learning possible at all in this environment. Right. At this point, we don't know, but we could have to put in a plexiglass dividers on every bus.
Right.
We just don't know yet.
Yeah. And, you know, this isn't really a comment, but, you know, Ann's question is true. Like the town grants the schools a blank number, right? Like, do we really? I mean, we review every line item in this budget and give you our feedback. And, you know, what we've done here is looked at your much shorter list of your suggestion. I do not want to get into the weeds and say, give us everything and take our feedback on every line. But our purview is somewhat more expansive than the town's when it comes to getting feedback about our suggestions. So I think, you know, we will look at this list and give you what we think. And I think we've been very clear about where that is. I'm comfortable supporting a number, John, which you're comfortable supporting, but there's room for dialogue, I think, ongoing, you know, in the contours of what that number means, you know, beyond this list. I think that's a conversation that we should continue to have. With the knowledge, it could vary $1 million if we need to run buses all day and we don't get that number until August. It's really, really hard. And I appreciate that it's really, really hard. You know, but I think our role here is very important in giving you our feedback in the context of taxpayers and how we think the money should be used.
I agree, Dan. And we've, you know, and we've been very, very open. It's been a partnership.
Yeah.
And, you know, when it comes to actually reducing positions, I do think that is something that we would, I'm not sure whether we need your approval on the reduction of positions, but we certainly would like your approval.
Right.
And so, you know, we're meeting again on the 9th. And we can try to finalize this. But again, as right. you said, this is finalizing it given what we know about going into to next year. And I think it's worth saying that our finance, the chair of the FinCom and the chair of the Selectmen have both acknowledged that those are big unknowns at this point. We may be back at the table at that point. And there's some efforts to make sure that the FinCom reserve is robust enough to be able to accommodate needs that we don't anticipate at this point. And that's something that I'm really appreciative of, that there's some work being done to try to make sure that reserve, right now, the reserve includes the $450,000 that is going to us for extraordinary out-of-district costs, and $516,000 to make sure that there's money available if the state cuts impact aid.
Yep.
Ben is looking at ways to potentially increase that reserve so that for that very purpose, if the schools need to go back and say we need $1 million, that money will be available.
Yep. You know, we have no system is supported by the town and the school committee more than Bedford's is. We are all on the same page. We're all in this together. And I appreciate everyone's effort from staff to committee to town leadership in making this happen. Appreciating how challenging this is. Now I'm officially finished. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you. Mr. Morrison, do you have any additional questions?
No questions, just a comment to sort of, you know, I think that one of the takeaways I get from this is that the next draft of this should probably show that there we're not going to reduce the third grade TA. And that's not a big amount of money. I think that the number would look a lot better without that line item as one of the reductions.
I think we can figure that out. We may be able to look at either our building rental or we'll look at drawing down a reserve a little further. You know, it's dangerous, but everything is up in the air for next year. So, you know, we can look at that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Scoville.
I agree with Brad, but thank you for offering the next round. I'm all set.
Okay. Thank you. John, anything further or do we move on to next agenda item?
So my question is, are you prepared to vote the number? And the reason why is that, I guess it could wait till the 9th, but they're looking to, in terms of the warrant, there's going to be a meeting with the Finance Committee on the 15th. So if you're not prepared tonight, I think we'll be okay on the 9th. But if you're okay voting the number and then going back in and looking at the specifics on the 9th, I think that would be fine. If this is Julie prepared what that number is. So it's $42,031,459. Which is a 0.4% increase over FY20.
School committee members, how do you feel, Mr. Broskow?
I think I'm about 70% comfortable voting the number. I know it's a tall ask. I would just like to see a couple more ideas of things that could go beyond this list, if possible. Mm-hmm. But the number is fine with me.
Excuse me, Dan, are you saying in addition to this list or?
Additional options to get us to the same number, maybe a couple different ideas. Cause I don't want to get into the details now. I agree with the third grade TA. Despite the literacy piece, I think if we take away foreign language now in third grade, if we're sitting here again next year or the following year, looking at a big hole, it's going to be impossible to get that position back in. Because that's what happens, you know, around. You take away a position, you take out language in third grade, and it never comes back, and I'm really, really hesitant to do so. So I'd rather see another way to cut money besides that position. That's my opinion. I could be outvoted on it. Maybe it isn't even my decision, John, and I appreciate that, but I do feel strongly about it, despite your excellent articulation of why literacy is important in the lost time in second grade. That's my only caveat to the conversation.
Okay. Mr. Morrison?
Well, I'm not sure I fully understand what the consequences of waiting until the 9th are. I see the benefit, which is basically what Mr. Broskow just described, which is there's an opportunity to do a little bit more, you know, take another look at this with a little bit of more guidance and thought from the taxpayer side. So if we can wait, I think we should. I just think we'll probably all feel better about the outcome if we can do that. But John, if there's is something about the urgency of this that I'm not appreciating, please explain that.
I'm sorry. I thought we were going to vote it tonight. And that was aligning with Sarah's plan to have the selectmen meet next week and then the finance committee. And I don't have those dates in front of me, so I'm not, I guess what I would say is that I would ask that we vote the number and that we pledge to come back with some alternatives in terms of how we get to that number, next Tuesday night. And I may bring, Dana, to be able to respond to questions about world language and Rob and Andrea to be able to speak to the literacy issues. So we can have a robust discussion about those things. And mm-hmm. we look, I will say that we've looked hard to go beyond this, and it's been very difficult to find other places. But we will come with an alternative proposal so that you can have that to discuss and share your direction with us. Okay, so that'd be my proposal. That we, if the number does not sound like that's being that's in contention, but rather certain aspects of how we're proposing to get to that number. So I would ask that you vote that, and we can move the town process forward while we look more deeply at our own school situation.
Sarah, do you have a comment? Or
I feel comfortable voting on the number and then waiting to hear adjustment ideas next week.
Okay. All right. So, John, can you tell me what the number is again?
Yes. Can you see the screen, by the way?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, you know what? I can't see the number at the bottom.
Okay, that's fine. I just wanted to make sure that it was.
I need to comment. And I don't like this approach, but it seems that everybody else is comfortable with it. I would have pushed it off till the 9th. But if you want a number, I guess we're going to have a number.
So the selectmen need us to approve a number that would go into a budget that they're voting on, in theory, in Monday. I just checked, and they don't have a meeting posted that I could see. So we would get a number so that they can have a number, so that Finance Committee can have a number for next Thursday night.
Well, Finance Committee is actually going to be on the 15th.
Okay. So that's 11 days away.
Yeah.
Joanne, could I just add something?
Certainly.
So what John is suggesting is the original proposed FY21 budget less the 1.278 collection of adjustments, mostly reductions, lands you on a number, which is a 0.4 increase over the FY21 budget. Mm-hmm. And we have been working closely with the town and, you know, are working collectively to meet that target, which we think is prudent. There's a commitment to adding dollars back if the situation is not as dire as it appears. So I think unless you disagree with the concept of and the work that's happened at that with those leaders, there's no reason not to vote the number tonight, especially if John is pledging to come back with options and possibly a sort of prioritized list of restorations. Does that help? Because the number is simply the original budget minus the reduction target that we have been working with, and which the town is thinks is very realistic, and that lands you on a number. It's not this list of line item adjustments that we've just reviewed.
Okay, so if we agree to this, if we vote on this amount and approve it, and something changes between now and next week or the time that this is, we have, you know, it will change the other numbers, it'll have some other impact. If the cost increases beyond what the assumptions are in this, then we would have to take the money out of something else, or we would have to revote the budget. Does that correctly characterize the situation?
Let me ask it a little differently. The only reason not to vote this number, which is the original FY21 minus the 1.278, is if the school committee wants to discuss whether it doesn't want to support $1,278,000 change from the original FY21 budget. if that's up for debate, mm-hmm. if it's too high or you think it's too low, then it's not time to vote the number.
Okay.
If the school committee agrees with the concept that we should reduce by 1.278, mm-hmm. wants to withhold approval around the kinds of reductions we're making, then there's no problem with voting the number because we can always discuss where it's coming from.
Okay. All right. I personally don't have a problem with the number. I just want to make sure that we're far enough along. And I know because I've had meetings with you and Julie and the other board heads and town staff about this. So I am generally very comfortable with the number. Any school committee members have, you're okay with taking vote now?
I'm sorry. My only final thought is, so it could be the scenario where we look at this list, where we talk about next week, where we come to a point where this is the best that we can do, and mm-hmm. we still feel compelled to say, well, we really have to have another $60,000 to do these three things that the five of us feel are critical. So in some ways, we are hamstringing ourselves mm-hmm. about going more than this. If we say, listen, we tried for 1.2x, we got to 1.115 because we feel like we absolutely have to have that, and that's our final say. If we want that flexibility, then tonight we don't vote the number. I'm not saying we have to do it, but that could be the mm-hmm. outcome where John says, we couldn't find anything else, this is the best, and then what do? Then we just say, we're gonna have cuts on prioritized putbacks, or we're gonna try to put the money back in, but then we can't unless you want to re-vote and it's too mm-hmm. late. So I am a little bit hesitant for that singular reason, but that's the argument against doing it. Although I'm not sure if I believe that we'll be able to get there with another week of looking at it and some more suggestions. But that's the decision point as I see it.
Well, let me just say if folks are not fully comfortable, I think we'll be okay by Tuesday night. It may mean that the selectmen might have to move their meeting to accommodate, you know, and have a meeting at the end of the week so that things are all set for FinCom on the 15th. Or maybe that meeting has, I mean, we've been asked to do this without a lot of time. The decision right. about when town meeting was going to happen was up in the air for months, and all of a sudden it got decided a week ago. So, you know, so I think I'm comfortable with waiting for Tuesday night, given those conditions. So I withdraw the request to have a vote on the number.
Okay. Okay, then we'll move on to the next item, John.
Next item is the...
Is EDCO?
Yes. Just a quick update on EDCO. First of all, one of the districts that had voted to withdraw has...
Sorry to interrupt. Can we go back to non-sharing of the screen? Is that okay? If you don't need, awesome. Thanks. Better.
The EDCO board met today, and I'm pleased to say that two things happened. One is that one of the districts, Belmont, that had planned to withdraw, has chosen to rescind its withdrawal. One of the districts that voted to withdraw, which is Concord/Concord-Carlisle, is saying that if EDCO turns things around this year, they will not withdraw because a school committee's vote to withdraw can't go into effect for a year. And